Thank you. To all the guests, thank you for joining us today and helping the state of Alabama commemorate this historic day. It is only when you look back at where we started.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, and let me stand. I'm tired.
My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is traveling round the nations where. up everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more backwards thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty. Wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. They're the ones who's coming up, and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children, teach them the very best you can. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. Gotta change it, yeah, just you and me. Wake up all the doctors, make the old people well. They're the ones who suffer and who catch all the hell. They don't have so very long before that judgment day. Won't you make them happy before they pass away? Up all the builders, time to build a new land. I know we can do it if we all lend a hand. The only thing we have to do is put it in our minds. Sure that things will work out, they do it every time. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. No, 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 no. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it, yeah, just you and me. Change it, yeah, change it, yeah, just you and me. Change it, yeah, change it, yeah. Can't do it alone.
Sit again, I know. stand in righteous indignation of the 21st century version of Jim Crow. But the real truth is that there are more qualified voters who do not vote than there are voters who cannot vote. Today, let us declare that the ocean has just arrived. It is an observation that is washed in the words of Jimmy Jackson, Reverend Ralph Reed, Viola Luizzo, and the victims of the Edmund Pettus Bridge. The roadway to justice, the freeway to equality, the highway to prosperity, and the byway of unconditional love all travel through the voting booth. We may march in the roads from Selma to Montgomery that crisscross the American landscape. We may demonstrate in cities both large and small and rise up for the absence of equality that still exists in our country. But the lines we must stand in to build a new America are those that lead to the ballot box. Let us all have hope for our children and grandchildren, for lives well lived and dreams fulfilled, looking beyond the sunset for the dawning of new days, where the next generations of Americans will be better for the choices that we make today through voting. Let us work for the day when our country embraces all of us, protects the least of us, and offers a bounty of hope and prosperity for not just some of us. For if we are all equal in God's eyes, then we must stand equal in our lives.
Amen.
We must live to learn and learn to live lives of purpose. We must understand that it takes courage to see people with our heart rather than our mind, for it can teach us the lessons of unconditional love. Let us remember that a person's leadership is not measured by the power that he has, but rather by the people he empowers. So let us rise when liberty demands it, walk when charity commands it, and rejoice when freedom is at hand. Quoting the scriptures, Dr. Martin Luther King once said that there would come a time when justice would flow down like a river and righteousness like a mighty stream. And 50 years ago today, he stated that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. And now, as the daughter of Governor Wallace, proudly stands with the daughter Bernice, with his daughter Bernice, at this moment and at this place, I believe that Dr. King would smile and say, Amen.
Right now.
tonight we have a very special announcement. He has prompted our hearts to tell you. Think about it these last few months.
It won't be long. Then we'll be leaving here.
We'll be leaving here.
It won't be long. We'll be going on. It won't be long.
Listen.
My mother was born on the soils of Alabama in Marion, Alabama, more specifically Highburg, Alabama. And I'm honored as we commemorate the 50th anniversary of my father's speech at the culmination of the historic Selma to Montgomery March. 50 years ago, in a state that was stubbornly transitioning from treacherous segregation to voting rights for long vilified people, the governor was not in attendance for my father's speech. Today, not only is the current governor of Alabama, Governor Bentley, here, but Peggy Wallace Kennedy, the daughter of the man who was governor in 1965, George Wallace, is here today to extend an olive branch on behalf of her late father. 50 years ago, it was malice that would not allow Daddy to speak from the steps of this Capitol. Instead, he spoke his powerful, timeless words from a flatbed truck in the midst of a boisterous and buoyant crowd. Today, I stand where he could not stand. To synthesize our past with our present and to speak those same profound words that he spoke. 50 years ago, my father's words reverberated in the atmosphere as the nation and the world grappled with the horror and inhumanity of man to man on Bloody Sunday. Today, I speak to you in awe from the experience of walking across the Edmund Pettus Bridge a few weeks ago with nonviolent warriors from that infamous day and with the first African-American president of the United States, President Barack Obama, and his family. It is 50 years later, and since that critical moment in history, we've made tremendous strides.
All right.
But let it not be lost on us that many of my father's words from 50 years ago still resonate today. They have the same power because we are facing similar issues. People of color are still subject to police brutality, with many unarmed who are unnecessarily being killed. Economic disparity and poverty continue to be cruel reminders of misplaced national priorities. The prison industrial complex, with its education to prison pipeline, is a perpetual blight against our moral consciousness. The Fair Housing Act is in jeopardy, and the gutting of the Voting Rights Act has opened the door for new voter suppression laws, even in this state, to disenfranchise many, turning back the clock on some of the progress we've made as a nation. Therefore, we as a people must demand that Congress restore the Voting Rights Act. And now is the time for the state of Alabama to rise to the occasion in this Jubilee year, to release itself from the harrowed past of oppressive, repressive, and suppressive laws, to ensuring laws that there's equal access to voting for all of its citizens. All of this serves as a reminder to us that tomorrow is today. We must operate with a fierce urgency of now. And if you are an unregistered voter, I'm appealing to you and urging you to register to vote now. Do not delay. We cannot live aimlessly as though our struggle is over. For in the words of my mother, struggle is a never-ending process. Freedom is never really won. You earn it and you win it in every generation. So today, you will now hear the words of the prophet King, my father, still speaking to us, providing us with wisdom, inspiration, and instruction to forge forward in our struggle to build the beloved community. And with truth and justice on our side, we march on. Now, I have been asked to share with you those words my daddy shared with the marches 50 years ago today. It is not an accident that one of the great marches of American history should terminate in Montgomery, Alabama. Just 10 years ago, in this very city, a new philosophy was born of the Negro struggle. Montgomery was the first city in the South in which the entire Negro community united and squarely faced its age-old oppressors. Out of this struggle, more than bus desegregation was born. A new idea, more powerful than guns or clubs, was born. Negroes took it and carried it across the South in epic battles that electrified the nation and the world. Strangely, the climactic conflicts always were fought and won on the Alabama soil. White America was profoundly aroused by Birmingham because it witnessed the whole community of Negroes facing terror and brutality with majestic scorn and heroic courage. And from the wells of this democratic spirit, the nation finally forced Congress to write legislation in the hope that it would eradicate the stain of Birmingham. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 gave Negroes some part of their rightful dignity. But without the vote, it was dignity without strength. Once more, the method of nonviolent resistance was unsheathed from its scabbard, and once again, an entire community was mobilized to confront the adversary. And again, the brutality of a dying order shrieks across the land. Yet Selma, Alabama, became a shining moment in the conscience of man. If the worst in American life lurked in its dark streets, the best of American instincts arose passionately from across the nation to overcome it. The confrontation of good and evil compressed in the tiny community of Selma generated the massive power to turn the whole nation to a new course. President Johnson rightly praised the courage of the Negro for awakening the conscience of the nation. On our part, we must pay our profound respects to to the white Americans who cherish their democratic traditions over the ugly customs and privileges of generations and come forth boldly to join hands with us. From Montgomery to Birmingham, from Birmingham to Selma, from Selma back to Montgomery, a trail wound in a circle long and often bloody, yet it has become a highway up from darkness. Alabama has tried to nurture and defend evil, but evil is choking to death in the dusty roads and streets of this state. So I stand before you this afternoon with the conviction that segregation is on its deathbed in Alabama. And the only thing uncertain about it is how costly the segregationist and Wallace will make the funeral. Our whole campaign in Alabama has been centered around the right to vote and focusing the attention of the nation and the world today on the flagrant denial of the right to vote. We are exposing the very origin of the racial segregation in the Southland. Racial segregation as a way of life did not come about as a natural result of hatred between the races immediately after the Civil War. There were no laws segregating the races then. Toward the end of the Reconstruction era, something very significant happened. That is what was known as the populist movement. The leaders of this movement began awakening the poor white masses and the former Negro slaves to the fact that they were being fleeced by the emerging bourbon interests. Not only that, but they began uniting the Negro and white masses in a voting bloc that threatened to drive the bourbon interests from the command post of political power in the South. To meet this threat, the Southern aristocracy began immediately to engineer this development of a segregated society. I want you to follow me through here because it's very important to see the roots of racism and the denial of the right to vote. Through their control of mass media, they revised the doctrine of white supremacy. They saturated the thinking of the poor white masses with it, thus clouding their minds to the real issue in the populist movement. They then directed the placement on the books of the South laws that made it a crime for Negroes and whites to come together as equals at any level. That crippled and eventually destroyed the populist movement of the 19th century. If it may be said of slavery era that the white man took the world and gave the Negro Jesus, then it may be said of the Reconstruction era that the Southern aristocracy took the world and gave the poor white man Jim Crow. And when his wrinkled stomach cried out for the food that his empty pockets could not provide, he ate Jim Crow, a psychological bird that told him no matter how bad off he was, at least he was a white man, better than the black man. And when his undernourished children cried out for the necessities that low wages could not provide, he showed them the Jim Crow signs on the buses and in the stores, on the streets and in the public buildings. And his children too learned to feed upon Jim Crow. Thus, the threat of the free exercise of the ballot by the Negro and white masses alike resulted in the establishment of a segregated society. They segregated Southern money from the poor whites. They segregated Southern mores from the rich whites. They segregated Southern churches from Christianity. They segregated Southern minds from honest thinking. And they segregated the Negro from everything. That's what happened when the Negro and white masses of the South threatened to unite and build a great society. A society where none would prey upon the weakness of others. A society of plenty where greed and poverty would be done away. A society of brotherhood where every man would respect the dignity and worth of human personality. We've come a long way since that travesty of justice was perpetrated upon the American mind. Today, I want to tell the city of Selma. Today, I want to say to the state of Alabama. Today, I want to say to the people of America and the nations of the world that we are not about to turn around. We're on the move now. Yes, we're on the move, and no wave of racism can stop us. We're on the move now. The burning of our churches will not deter us. The bombing of our homes will not dissuade us. We're on the move now. The beating and killing of our clergymen and young people will not divert us. We're on the move now. The wanton release of their known murderers would not discourage us. We are moving to the land of freedom. Let us therefore continue our triumphant march to the realization of the American dream. Let us march on segregated housing until every ghetto or social and economic depression dissolves and Negroes and whites live side by side in decent, safe, and sanitary housing. Let us march on segregated schools until every vestige of segregated and inferior education becomes a thing of the past. And Negroes and whites study side by side in the socially healing context of the classroom. Let us march on poverty until no American parent has to skip a meal so that their children may eat. March on poverty until no starved man walks the streets of our cities and towns in search of jobs that do not exist. And let us march on poverty until wrinkled stomachs in Mississippi are filled and broken lives in sweltering ghettos are mended and remolded. Let us march on ballot boxes until race baiters disappear from the political arena. Let us march on ballot boxes until the Wallaces of our nation tremble away in silence. Let us march on ballot boxes until we send to our city councils, state legislators, and the United States Congress, men who will not fear to do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with thy God. Let us march on ballot boxes until brotherhood becomes more than a meaningless word in an opening prayer, but the order of the day on every legislative agenda. Let us march on ballot boxes until all over Alabama, God's children will be able to walk the earth in decency and honor. I know that there is a cry today in Alabama. We see it in numerous editorials. When will Martin Luther King, SCLC, SNCC, and all these civil rights agitators and all of the white clergymen and labor leaders and students and others get out of our community and let Alabama return to normal? But I have a message that I would like to leave with Alabama. That is exactly what we don't want. And we will not allow it to happen, for we know that it was normalcy in Marion that led to the brutal murder of Jimmie Lee Jackson. It was normalcy in Birmingham that led to the murder on Sunday morning of four beautiful, unoffending, innocent girls. It was normalcy on Highway 80 that led state troopers to use tear gas and horses and billy clubs against unarmed human beings who were simply marching for justice. It was normalcy in a cafe in Selma, Alabama, that led to the brutal beating of Reverend James Reed. It is normalcy all over our country, which leaves the Negro perishing on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of vast ocean of material prosperity. It is normalcy all over Alabama that prevents the Negro from becoming a registered voter. No, we will not allow Alabama to return to normalcy.
All right.
The only normalcy that we will settle for is the normalcy that recognizes the dignity and worth of all of God's children.
All right.
The only normalcy that we will settle for is the normalcy of brotherhood, the normalcy of true peace, the normalcy of justice. I must admit to you that there are still some difficult days ahead.
Come on.
We're still in for a season of suffering in many of the Black Belt counties of Alabama, many areas of Mississippi, many areas of Louisiana. I must admit to you that there are still jail cells waiting for us. But if we will go on with the faith that nonviolence and its power can transform dark yesterdays into bright tomorrows, we will be able to change all of these conditions. I know you are asking today, how long will it take? Somebody's asking, how long will prejudice blind the visions of men, darken their understanding, and drive bright-eyed wisdom from her sacred throne? Somebody's asking, when will wounded justice lying prostrate on the streets of Selma and Birmingham and communities all over the South be lifted from this dust of shame to reign supreme among the children of men? Somebody's asking, how long will justice be crucified and truth buried? I come to say to you this afternoon, however difficult the moment, however frustrating the hour, it will not be long, because truth crushed to the earth will rise again. How long? Not long. Because no lie can live forever. How long? Not long. Because you shall reap what you sow.
Hallelujah.
How long? Not long. Truth forever on the scaffold, wrong forever on the throne. Yet that scaffold sways the future, and behind the dim unknown standeth God within the shadow, keeping watch above his own. How long? Not long. Because the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. How long? Not long. Because mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath store. He has loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
You know, you and I have been through many hardships in life. As a people who believe, hardship has made us doubt the very God of gods. But the Apostle Paul said in the scripture, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but we are never destroyed. And the conclusion of the whole matter is that finally, the storm is over. It's time for us to reap what we have sown. No doubt, my brothers and sisters, God has given us a miracle. Finally, Blackstreet.
Finally, we'll make it through the storm and the rain. time to give and praise and bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
If you believe in miracles,
come on,
just you wait and see. 'Cause finally we'll make it through it all.
We've made it. Come on, let's fellowship. Let's bless the Lord.
Sometimes there's no way out. I know He's there
to lead,
leading me and guiding me
every step of the way.
Every step of the way, yeah.
His grace,
Your grace, my joy.
He's a friend that's taking
constant
close to
the friend
level.
Indeed. Everything that I do.
For the good to them that love the Lord. It's time for us to speak to those things that are not as though they were. So I command every household to be blessed. I command every marriage to work out. I command every broken heart to be healed. I command prosperity upon my life. It's my time. It's my time. Finally, finally, the miracle is here. Come on, Black Street. Come on, Love Fellowship.
I know, but tomorrow tomorrow. I thought about today, but it's so much easier to say tomorrow. Who promised you tomorrow? Better choose the Lord today, for tomorrow very well might be too late. Jesus said, I stand, won't you please take my hand? And you say, I will tomorrow. Jesus said, I am he.
Oh, so Caesar.
That all of you let see. Will one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love. Oh, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Yes, they will.
Beyond the sky, it's real.